This video is brought to you by CuriosityStream. Get 30 days of free documentaries on the link down below. Ryzen 3000 generation hype, Zen 2 architecture for increased performance, Navi architecture, a return to a semblance of reasonable pricing in the PC gaming industry, all for the low entry price of $200. The price of an entire game console. Okay, so I'm actually a fan of the Ryzen series. Its introduction meant a comparatively cheaper alternative to Intel that is forcing them to compete and at least do something to deal with the rising cost of enthusiast PC gaming. Most of them tend to be outside my range of affordability, but things changed when they started doing Ryzen APUs. While AMD was off wooing people with the second generation Ryzen 12 nanometer Zen Plus architecture, they released a couple of more affordable 14 nanometer Zen APUs. It's like trickle-down economics, only that it is new-gen tech making last-gen tech more affordable and easier to produce, and that in here it's actually a real thing that works. And these were APUs, which means they came with integrated graphics using Vega, which was at the time their best graphics architecture. AMD had successfully managed to combine their CPU and GPU expertise in something that redefined a lot of what people thought of integrated graphics. While I was initially skeptical of these products, mainly due to them scratching the surface of what I will consider entry-level in terms of pricing, I eventually warmed up to their benefits, and so did many people online, as you can rarely look for a budget quote-unquote console killer build guide online. We had seen one of these. When they eventually managed to cut the same tech down to a $55 budget, I was very much on board, and this leap in integrated performance definitely caught Intel's attention, which now seems ready to respond, something that I'm very much looking forward to testing. So when the fabled 7nm Zen 2 started showing its head and all the mainstream tech channels were busy talking about its bazillion cores, my eyes turned into the lower part of the table, where two new Zen Plus APUs sat waiting in plain sight. The cheapest of them was the Ryzen 3 3200G, taking the place of the 2200G in terms of pricing, but with a number of improvements, most notable on the CPU side, and it is an interesting example of how with every new generation, what can you get for the same price changes in a positive way. Same 4 cores, but a jump from the first generation Zen architecture to the last generation Zen Plus architecture, with some improvements on clocks. Let's start testing with that before even touching on the topic of GPU. For testing CPU power, most channels out there use CSGO, but frankly, any game that's like done using an old engine is going to be CPU bound if you use a f***ing RTX 2080, and even if I use it on a low resolution to tax the integrated GPU as little as possible in a quick benchmark map, it is hard to tell what is actually improvement from the CPU and what is from the GPU at this level of performance, so this is not very interesting to me. Let's try the latest Assassin's Creed games. Either due to a quirk of the DRM or just weird CPU optimization, both of these games use way too many CPU resources, which makes them the bane of entry-level CPUs. If you drop the internal resolution to very dramatic low levels and disable some effects using the tricks on the respective videos in the corner, the CPU quickly becomes the main performance limiter. Now, on the old generation 2200G, the CPU did quite well, but it did stutter and freeze while hitting 100 CPU usage on certain areas of Assassin's Creed Origins. On Odyssey, the newer game, it is not as horrible optimized, so it does a fair bit better, but the results were a little bit disappointing when you consider that on the CPU front, this guy was able to do 60 FPS on pretty much any other game on lowest settings. So how does a jump to Zen Plus benefit the 3200G? Quite a lot, frankly. Frame rate at Origins is immediately not only higher, but way more stable, as stuttering is almost completely gone. And on the side of Odyssey, there's an obvious jump in performance. Like, seriously, this is way more of a jump in performance than I expected, and it borders on a 60fps average sometimes, which I have seen older gaming CPUs struggling to maintain on this game. The jump to Zen Plus was not a joke. Now, the surprise of the CPU improvements is contrasted by the initial disappointment in integrated GPU, as this time we find that it basically has the same integrated GPU as the older 2200G. While I was secretly hoping for Navi, the new architecture, in retrospective, it is obvious that such new technology might not be mature enough to be put on such a small package just yet. So what we get is the same Vega 8 integrated GPU at a slightly better clocks, not even more Vega cores, which is weird. This very modest change does not mean much. For example, I run the better optimized game, Far Cry 5, on vanilla lowest settings and full 720p, and the gains from Ryzen 2200G to 3200G are modest. Good, but like not earth-shattering or anything like that. But this, my dear viewers, is not the full story. I was surprised when I noticed that even when confronted with a GPU stress test, the integrated GPU temperature was not very high. My very uneducated guess is that improvements in Zen Plus or better thermal design fed some of the thermal budgets, which allows the increase in clocks and space for even a bit more. Now, I have proven in past videos that I'm no overclocking expert, and other people have shown me that there are many variables inside the CPU and its temperature that influence what can be achieved, such as a higher quality power supply that is able to keep a stable voltage, or better motherboards that filter that power supply or have better cooling on the voltage regulators. But even on a very overkill cooling and power supply setup, my old 2200G could only reach 1700 MHz on the GPU. So imagine my surprise when using a suspiciously cheap power supply and an okay motherboard with nothing but the dinky stock cooler, I could easily hit 1800 MHz right before hitting what are probably unsafe voltages for this component. 1800 MHz on the stock cooler with acceptable temperatures, that's crazy! In fact, the only reason why I could not use it is that upon opening any game, the GPU will start artifacting. But at the clock speed of 1700 MHz that require all that freaking preparation on the 2200G, it was not a problem for the 3200G and the stock cooler. Results will vary, because on every overclock you will be depending on the silicon lottery, but this is still very encouraging. The combination of an ease of GPU overclocking and the improved Zen Plus CPU led to great results, such in Assassin's Creed Odyssey, but this time in full 720 and at least 30fps, so nothing more than the integrated GPU. Considering the performance problems that this fantastic but heavy game can have, this is rather good. These CPUs are usually marketed at esport titles, which is a code word for better optimized competitive games which tend to have an esports league built around them. Not you, we will talk about you later. Oh yeah, big surprise, on the fantastically optimized Overwatch, it can do full 1080p at nearly 60fps on this configuration without any problem, only dropping in some really crazy moments, and even yet, being pretty acceptable. Let's throw some crazier stuff at it then, like Wolfenstein 2 The New Colossus. This is one of those titles that can be trouble to even dedicated GPUs, and yet on this core room combat scene, the overclocked GPU is easily able to keep 60fps or more, and this is at 720p with no resolution scaling and shadows still enabled, which is usually the thing I recommend for this game when struggling on your low-end PC. Of all the games I tried, this result is by far the one that surprised me the most, as I don't think I had played this game with shadows enabled on an integrated GPU ever before. So let's talk about Nier Automata. Apart from being just a really good game, it is often a good test of GPU power due to its computationally expensive global illumination. However, even with that illumination enabled, the overclocked Vega 8 had zero trouble with the game in 720p, which encouraged me to jump into 1080, which we had less luck with. Thankfully, I did a video on this game and on the FAR mod that can disable that global illumination for what is usually a substantial boost. While the difference can be dramatic on older GPUs, here it is slight, but important in the long term. Not quite 60fps, but still very surprising performance for a game of this caliber. And talking about 1080, before I singled out PUBG as the one exception among the esporty games that tends to be better optimized, and historically it gives integrated GPUs a harder time. While updates through time have improved both the optimization and quality of things like animations, it is still surprising to see that on the lowest settings, this guy can fully do 1080p with no resolution scaling on this rather big game. another very good sign. So, while on paper the changes between the 2200G and the 3200G does not seem extremely dramatic, in practice there's a bit of a hidden story in here. The jump to Zen Plus represents an improvement in performance that is noticeable on those extremely CPU-heavy games, and on the GPU department, we get basically the same Vega 8, with a small clock boost, but improvement on the thermals somewhere else makes it easier to overclock further without changing the stock cooler, which at least in the case of my unit, meant that I could reach the limits of 1700 MHz with acceptable temperatures and voltages, only limited by actual artifacting in the GPU. Those improvements in thermals translate to unexpectedly good performance, even on 1080 on some of the harder to run games using some tricks. Add to those improvements to the Ryzen overclocking software and motherboard BIOS, which make it easy to set frequencies and voltages with a quick test without a reboot, and you can see how the weird trickle down of technology is actually making the Zen Plus chips some of the most interesting things to come out of the 3000 series. We will see how the more expensive 3600G does soon enough. Although, if you know me well, you know that I am more interested is in how this is going to change the new generation of cheap Athlon APUs or how Intel's new GPU architecture is going to compete. But we will talk about those when the time comes. It is an interesting time to be an enthusiast for the cheaper side of PC gaming. It is, in general, a decent time to be a nerd with interesting indie and AAA games available coming and tons of cheap streaming services for content, including CuriosityStream. You know how in Wolfenstein you're fighting robot Nazis in, like, a moon base? A lot of it's inspired by some of the frankly absurd experimental weapons that Nazis tried during World War II, especially during the final stretch of the war. It is a topic that is so weird that you can't help but be fascinated by it, and you can learn lots about it on this fantastic documentary called Hitler's Miracle Weapons, which is just one of the many high-quality pieces you can find there. I was a bit late in finishing the script of this video because I kinda got stuck watching this, and if historical weapons are not really your thing, you can find something else to watch among the 2,400 documentaries and non-fiction content of CuriosityStream, a streaming service by the founders of the Discovery Channel, available on browser, phone, smart TV, and all the usual platforms for just $2.99 a month, which is seriously nothing for the level of quality they offer. And if you want to try for no money and support the channel in the process, you can go to curiositystream.com/lowspecgamer and get a 30-day free trial. Just be careful not to start a bench session, which might be one of the reasons why this video is a couple of days later than I hope. Thank you to them for sponsoring this video, and you for watching.